morning, beloved, and welcome to this, our virtual worship service for the fourth Sunday in the month of March, which also happens to be Palm Sunday.
Amen.
We're all here at the invitation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who said to each and every one of us, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations.
First of all, Lord, for waking us up this morning and allowing us to see another day, Father. Thanking you, Lord, for allowing us to assemble together once again to worship and to praise your holy name, Father. To give you the glory that you deserve, Lord. We ask you, Father, to bless this service as only you can, Father. That your spirit, Lord, will work in and through Reverend Dukes this day, Lord. And bring your word this day, Father. That your spirit, Lord, will work through Alicia and Brian, Father God. Bring music and song this day, Lord. We ask you, Father, to make this service into what you will have it to be, Lord. Blessed Lord, as only you can. It's our prayer, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Me.
We thank you, Lord, for that sweet, sweet hour of prayer.
Yes.
We're now ready for our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
Glory be.
lest I forget Gethsemane.
Yes.
Lest I forget thine agony.
Yes.
Lest I forget thy love for me. Oh Lord, lead me to Calvary.
That's
all right, Alicia and Brian.
Amen.
All right. It is now offering time.
Yes.
As we've been saying each and every week, we ask that you will truly give of how God has blessed you and help be a asset to this ministry.
Mm-hmm.
You can give by way of Givelify. Look for Fountain Spring Baptist Church, 2011 Grand Concourse. Or you can mail your checks or money orders payable to Fountain Spring Baptist Church and mail them to Post Office Box 644, Ardsley, New York, 10502. You can also give by way of Zelle to fountainspringbc@gmail.com, or you can give by Cash App to $FountainSpring. Always remember that God loveth a cheerful giver.
Yes, sir.
And also all that we have, for all things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own hath we given thee.
Amen.
Amen. This being Palm Sunday, we thought that we would do as we would usually do at this portion of our service and come together to bless these palms that I have before me.
Yes.
And so I'm going to ask that you will bow your head and let us pray God's blessing upon these palms. Eternal God, our Father, we once again come before your holy divine presence. We come, O God, on this very special day,
yes,
a day where we look back and remember the entry of thy Son and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ into the city of Jerusalem.
Yes.
We are told, Father God, by your word, that as he entered, many people took palms down from the trees, took off their clothing and strode them in the way.
Yes.
Now, Lord, as we are preparing on this Palm Sunday to remember just how much you loved us,
yes,
we ask that you will help us to understand the true meaning of Palm Sunday. And Father God, let this be a reminder to us of your love for us.
Yes.
That your Son was willing to give of himself and to come as that suffering sacrificial lamb,
yes,
so that we might have a right to the tree of life.
Thank you.
Not only we ask you to bless these palms,
yes,
but bless all of us who will receive them. No matter where we might be, Father God, bless us now. Even if we don't receive physically the palms,
yes,
spiritually, let us know that your palms be upon us.
Yes.
This we ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
We're now ready for our congregational hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Say, oh.
The Lord is in his holy temple.
The Lord is in his holy temple.
Let all the earth keep silent.
Let all the earth keep silent.
Before him. Just before Alicia comes back to us with the next song, I do want to announce that this coming Friday, being Good Friday, we have been asked by the good people of the Walker Memorial Baptist Church and its esteemed pastor, the Reverend Joe Albert Bush, to be the preacher for their Good Friday service. They have also allowed us to broadcast this service on our YouTube and Facebook network.
Amen.
Therefore, this coming Friday, April the 2nd, at 12 noon Eastern Daylight Saving Time, you can go to YouTube or to Facebook or at any time thereafter and see the Good Friday service that is held by the Walker Memorial Baptist Church, where your humble servant will be the preacher for that occasion.
Amen.
We ask that you will kindly join us, and may the Lord bless you on this coming Good Friday.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Let's bow our heads. Our Father and our God, we come once again into your holy divine presence. We come, O Lord, as humbly as we know how. We come to you thanking you for your love, for your mercy, for your grace. We thank you, Lord, that we are shown and we feel your love for the suffering of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're reminded that you loved us so much until you sent him into the world, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And now, Lord, on this Palm Sunday, remind us once again of all that he sacrificed just for us. Now, Lord, have your own way. Oh, yes, Lord, have your own way. For truly thou art the potter, and we are the clay. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. This Palm Sunday, we'd like to invite you to join with us as we look at the record of the first Palm Sunday, as recorded in the Gospel according to St. John, the 12th chapter. And we want to look at the 13th and the 12th and the 13th verse.
Amen.
On the next day, much people that will come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. On the next day, much people that will come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I'd like to talk for the next few moments on the subject, Behold the Lamb of God.
Yes, amen.
Behold,
amen.
The Lamb of God. Actually, this subject, these words, behold, the Lamb of God, are taken also from this gospel according to St. John. John, in his very first chapter, after introducing us to God, then going on to talk about the forerunner of Jesus Christ, man by the name of John the Baptist. After introducing us to John the Baptist, having us to understand that many people came thinking John the Baptist was indeed that Messiah that was promised. But John denied that he was he. He said that there was one that was coming after him, whose shoes he was not worthy to unloose. John, in this first chapter of the Gospel of John, states that on the very next day, John the Baptist sees Jesus coming down to the Jordan. And he says to his followers, his disciples, those around him, he sees Jesus and he looks up and he says, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. On this Palm Sunday, we want to once again behold, look at the Lamb of God. It's interesting on this Palm Sunday that when you search the gospel records, Matthew, Mark, and Luke give somewhat similar accounts of this, what is called triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. Matthew tells us that multitudes begin to cry out, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest. Matthew goes on to tell us that when Jesus came into the city of Jerusalem, that all the city was moved, crying out, who is this? And the multitude replied, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. Mark adds some information to this incident by informing us that before his entry into Jerusalem, Jesus says to two of his disciples, I want you to go into the village over against you. And as soon as you enter into it, ye shall find a colt tied where never man sat. Loose him and bring him to me.
Yes, sir.
We're going to come back to that statement that Jesus makes. Luke goes on to let us know that as the multitude begin to rejoice and to praise God for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. That as the multitude was crying out and rejoicing, the Pharisees, Jesus' adversaries, got upset.
Yes.
And they even said to Jesus, Master.
Yes.
Notice they called him Master.
Yes, sir.
Master, they said, rebuke thy disciples. But Jesus said unto them, I tell you that if these shall hold their peace, the very stones would immediately cry out. Matthew, Mark, and Luke tells us about this event, this entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And all of them have one thing in common. They talk about the multitudes and the people that would come to Jerusalem to keep the feast. When they heard that this man Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, they all ran out to meet him.
Mm-hmm.
Some pulling down palms from palm trees.
Yeah.
Some taking off their coats and laying them in the pathway as he made his entry into Jerusalem, riding upon a colt, which never a man had ever ridden on. And they all were rejoicing. And they were rejoicing and they were crying out, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. But what we want to really realize is that with all their rejoicing, they missed the purpose for which Jesus was sent. They thought that he was coming, this Jesus, this man who they had heard about, this man who had the reputation for giving sight to the blind, for unstopping deaf ears, for feeding multitudes with simply two fish and five loaves of bread, for making the lame to walk. This Jesus that was able to heal the sick, this Jesus that was able to cure people, even if they just touched the hem of his garment. This Jesus who was able to speak to the winds of the waves and say, peace be still. And they marveled that even the waves and the sea obey his will. This Jesus who even raised the dead. This Jesus was now coming into Jerusalem. And the multitude somehow had the thought within their mind that the time had arrived for this Jesus who could do all these mighty things, all these miraculous things, all these marvelous works, was coming to turn over the Roman Empire, which Jerusalem and all of Israel was subject to. He would ride in and kick the Romans out and take his rightful place on the throne of his father, King David. That's not why he came.
That's right.
That's not why he came.
That's right.
It's interesting that it is the Gospel of John.
Yeah.
That same gospel.
Yeah.
that introduces us to Jesus in that very first chapter.
Yes.
By declaring, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Within that statement, it is John in this 12th chapter that gives us a clue to why Jesus came.
Gotcha.
Before we even go into that clue that John gives in this 12th chapter, his coming really is not only for a fulfillment of all of the history of the Old Testament, but in particular, it is the fulfillment of a statement made thousands of years ago by Abraham. You recall in Genesis chapter 22, where God says to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son that thou lovest, and I want you to take him to a place that I will tell you of, and when you get there, I want you to offer him as a burnt offering to me. And as Abraham obeyed the will of God, even though God was commanding him to take his only son, Isaac, and to build an altar and lay him on it and to stab him to death and then burn his body as a sacrifice to Almighty God. Do you recall that when Abraham got to the place that God wanted him to do this at, his son Isaac, once Abraham and Isaac had separated from the young men that came along on the journey with him, his son Isaac said to him, Father?
Yes.
Abraham responded, Here am I. Isaac said, Father, I see the wood.
Yes.
I have the knife and the fire. But Father, where is the lamb for the sacrifice? And Abraham responded according to the King James Version.
Yes.
My son, God will provide himself a lamb for the back burnt offering. And that, in saying that, Abraham, if you're not careful of how you define and understand what he means when he said the word himself, if some people take it to mean, well, God's going to provide himself. He's going to find something to be the sacrifice. No, that's not what Abraham is saying. Abraham is literally saying God will provide himself to be a lamb for the burnt offering. And then comes Jesus riding upon a colt. Remember, he made the statement to his disciples, I want you to go get this colt, where never a man sat upon.
Yeah.
Previous to this, this colt no doubt carried many burdens, many animals, many other types of burdens, but never a man. Here we come to the Gospel of John. And God, through the Gospel of John, helps us to understand the true meaning of what we refer to as Palm Sunday.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't enter Jerusalem to become king and to overthrow the Romans.
Amen.
No, he entered Jerusalem in accordance to the will of our Heavenly Father.
That's right.
John gives us the clues, for he opens up this 12th chapter by saying, then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, he comes to Bethany and he goes to the home of Lazarus and Martha and Mary. While he's in his home, John says that Mary takes out a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and she begins to anoint the feet of Jesus. And the aroma filled the house. It's interesting that one of Jesus' own disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, the one that John says which should betray him, he objected to this, what he thought was a waste of money that Mary was pouring upon the feet of Jesus. But Jesus responded to Judas, "Let her alone, for against the day of my burial hath she kept this. For the poor you have with you always, but me ye have not always." Now notice, John informs us in that very first verse that this takes place 6 days before the Passover. In verse number 12, John goes on to say, on the next day, which would have been 5 days before the Passover. Much people that will come to the feast. What feast, Mr. Preacher? The feast of Passover. Because they were commanded by God from the time of Moses that they should all gather at the Passover in the place, the special place that God had designated. And so much people had come from all Judea and all surrounding communities. Jews were flocking to Jerusalem to keep the feast of the Passover. But as they came to the feast, they heard that Jesus was also coming to Jerusalem. And therefore, as verse 13 tells us, they took branches of palm trees and they went forth to meet him, crying, "Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel." For they thought he was coming to take over the throne of his father David. That's not why he came. Notice, John tells us, first verse, 6 days before the Passover. 12th verse, the next day, much people came to the feast, met Jesus with palms, and cried out, "Hosanna to the King of Israel." This next day would have been 5 days before the Passover. Now, let us try to understand what God, through John, is trying to tell us. We have to go back, believe it or not, to the book of Exodus, the 12th chapter. In the 12th chapter of the book of Exodus, God says to Moses and to Aaron, he says, "This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year." He goes on to say, "Speak ye unto the congregation of Israel, saying to them, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers." Amen. God goes on to tell them in verse 5, that your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it from out of the sheep or from the goats. And then he goes on to tell them, and ye shall keep that lamb that you have taken until the 14th day of this same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill that lamb in the evening. He goes on to let them know, "And thus shall ye eat of this lamb, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and ye shall, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste, for it is the Lord's Passover." But he also told them, "When you kill it in the evening, that ye shall take the blood of that lamb and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat of it." Notice he tells them that on the 10th day of the month, every household shall go out and find the lamb, bring it back, and keep it until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of Israel shall gather together and kill their individual lambs at evening. The 10th day, the 11th day, the 12th day, the 13th day, the 14th day. Between the 10th and the 14th day, there are 5 days. They are to take the lamb on the 10th day, hold it until the 14th day, and kill it at evening. Look what John tells us. Jesus shows up in Bethany 6 days before the Passover. The very next day, we find him entering into Jerusalem. He enters into Jerusalem 5 days before the Passover. He comes in on a Sunday, the first day. The second day is Monday. The third day is Tuesday. The fourth day is Wednesday. And lo and behold, the fifth day, the day of Passover, is Thursday. My Bible tells me that on that Passover, Jesus gathered his disciples there in the upper room. And he began to talk about his arrest, his betrayal, and yes, even his crucifixion. Jesus did not come to set up an earthly kingdom. No, he came to fulfill the command of a heavenly kingdom. He came to be that sacrificial lamb. For God informs us through the words of his prophet Isaiah that surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord have laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a lamb before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Behold the Lamb of God. Look at him as he rides into the streets of Jerusalem. See him as he comes riding on a colt. Imagine in your mind's eye that all over Jerusalem on this day, people are bringing their lambs and their goats, some of them riding on colts, also bound with their feet because they're too heavy for them to carry. And along comes Jesus, riding on a colt where never a man sat before, riding just as a lamb, coming into Jerusalem on that 10th day of this holy month. And they would keep him, and he would continue to do what he did until that 14th day. And when we come to the day of Passover, that Thursday night, Jesus sits with his disciples. Bible says after they kept the Passover, Jesus instituted at that very moment what we now refer to as the Lord's Supper. He said, because he took bread, and when he lifted up his eyes and gave thanks to his heavenly Father, he broke the bread and told them that this bread represented his broken body. He passed it to his disciples and said, eat ye all of it. When they had eaten of the bread, he took the cup in his hands. And when he had once again given thanks to his heavenly Father, he told them that this cup represented his blood of a new testament. Old Testament didn't work. Old Testament was based on a conditional precept. Old Testament it just has so many clauses in it that God says, if you do this, then I'll do that.
Yes.
If you obey and keep all my commandments, then I'll give you eternal life.
Yes.
Unfortunately, sinful man could never live up to the demands of a holy God.
Yes.
So Jesus had to come to put away that old testament, that old covenant, that old will that couldn't do us no good. And he brought in a new testament based on his blood, a new will where our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. Oh, I don't know about you, but I join with the multitude, for I'm rejoicing now. But I'm not rejoicing because he came to set up an earthly kingdom. I'm rejoicing because he fulfilled the will of God and set up an eternal heavenly kingdom. Not only did he set it up, but I'm rejoicing as he told his disciples, because my name is written in the Lamb's book of life. Behold, the Lamb of God. For he's worthy. Oh yes, he's worthy. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Because by his blood are we saved. By his blood are we cleansed. He has set the prisoners free. And as he said, if the Son shall set you free, then you shall be free indeed.
Yes, he will.
Behold the Lamb. Behold the Lamb. Behold the Lamb. Look at him. Look at him coming in lowly and meek. Look at him coming to make a way for you out of no way. Look at him as he comes to do his Father's will. Look at him as he makes his journey on to Good Friday and to Calvary. Behold, behold, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world.
Thank you.
the spring, we always hope that God will use this service to open blind eyes. And if you are one of those that God has opened your eyes today, we encourage you to find a church where the gospel is being preached and taught. And if you're having a problem finding a church in your area, reach out to us. We may be able to assist you. And we pray that there is someone here today that God has opened your eyes. Or perhaps there's someone who just, your fellowship with the Lord is not right, and you want to recommit yourself today. There may be someone who's viewing today who you, that this ministry has touched your heart. And you would like to become a part of it. Drop us a line, and we'll tell you what you have to do. But either way, we pray that God will continue to keep you and yours. And now we open the doors to altar prayer. Those who desire prayer, you could assemble around the altar right where you are. But first of all, we want to thank God for what he has done already. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you, Father God, for reminding us today the price that you paid, Lord, for our salvation. Father God, we thank you for Jesus Christ and all that he has done, all that he's doing right now, seated at the right hand of the Father, and all that he will do when he comes back again, Father. We thank you, Lord, for your word this day. We thank you for your servant that you use today, Lord. The grace, Lord, that you continue to give up to lead your people, Father, to do your will. Let your hand be mighty upon him, Father. Keep his mind, body, and his spirit strong, Father. As we come around your altar, Lord, we thank you, Father God, for the prayers that you've answered already, the ways that you've made already, Lord. And we pray, Father God, that you continue to be with us. Continue to bless us, Lord, and keep us, Father. Continue, Lord, to give us health and strength, Father God. Continue, Lord, to give us a right mind, Father. As we hold our petitions up to you, Father, Lord, only you know what we have been in need of. We pray that you would look on us as only you can and provide us with what we need. Those that we hold up to you, Father God, look on them, Lord, and provide what's needed, Father. We thank you for what you are doing in this world right now, this nation, Lord, this country, this city that we're in right now. And we pray, Father, that you will continue to bring healing, deliverance, Lord, to the land, Father. As this upcoming week comes, Father, yes, let us leave this place, Lord, and be beacons of light, Father. Let your light shine brightly through us, Father. Prepare us for what may come our way, Lord. Let us meet every challenge victorious, Lord. We love you, Father, and we'll forever bless and praise your holy name. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. It's because you're worthy to be praised. And now, Father, we come before you in that name that's above all other names. That name is Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now, just before the benediction, we want to remind you that you are invited to share with the good people of the Walker Memorial Baptist Church this coming Friday, Good Friday, April the 2nd, at 12 noon Eastern Daylight Saving Time, as we celebrate our Good Friday service. Join us on that day at that hour, or anytime afterwards on our network, and let us look at this day when Jesus died.
Amen.
Now we are ready for our benediction. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen.